Let's talk about banding data in spectrum measurements. As I discussed in part 3 of this series, FFT measurements convert time domain data into frequency domain data. The input to the FFT is a sampled waveform, which means that it's a list of amplitude values at linearly spaced points in time. That's just the essence of digital audio. The output of the FFT is a list of amplitude values at linearly spaced frequencies instead of time increments. We'll call each of these frequency data points a bin or a frequency bin. As explained in part 3, a 128 sample FFT will have frequencies that are multiples of 375 Hz. These bins are evenly spaced on a linear scale, but when dealing with sound waves, we look at FFT data on a logarithmic scale, because our perception of frequency is logarithmic. What that means is that a doubling of frequency, to us, is an octave shift in pitch. So, the difference between 3000 Hz and 6000 Hz is the same as the difference between 6000 Hz and 12000 Hz. So, what does this mean for our FFT data? When we view a graph of these linearly spaced frequency bins on a logarithmic scale, the bins appear closer together on the graph at higher frequencies than they do at lower ones. As we read from left to right, there are twice as many bins in each successive octave. Therefore, to make the graph meaningful to us, or to make it analogous to our hearing, it makes sense to give equal visual weight to each octave rather than to each frequency bin, and that's the job of data banding. Let's look at this in practice. This is a spectrum measurement of pink noise, with no averaging and no banding. You can see on the left side of the screen that there is a lower density of frequency bins than on the right side of the screen, where there are many. I'm going to turn on some averaging. I'm actually going to set it to infinite. And very quickly, you can see that the noise in our data is reduced. And what we end up with is a flat line that slopes down at 3 decibels per octave. You can see here at 1 kilohertz, the level is at about minus 53. If we go one octave higher, so at 2 kilohertz, it's at about minus 56, which is 3 decibels lower. So let's look at that somewhere else on the graph. From 125 hertz, where we're sitting at about minus 44, if we go up an octave, we're sitting at about minus 47, just 3 decibels lower. If we go down an octave to 63, we're sitting at about minus 41. So you can see that this pink noise, with significant averaging, we get a flat line sloping down at 3 decibels. Now let's look at this data with whole octave banding. We can still see our line with the raw FFT data, all of our frequency bins, but then our banded data is a flat level line as opposed to sloping down at 3 decibels like our frequency bin data does. And that's because each octave contains twice as many frequency bins as the one to the left of it. So our octave centered at 1k has a given number of bins. The octave centered at 2k has twice as many, but on average, they are 3 decibels lower. Because there are twice as many bins, the 2k octave is given a 3 decibel boost in the banding data, because 3 decibels represents a doubling of power. So again, the frequency bins in the 1k octave, when we look at our frequency bin data, this line here, they appear to be on average 3 decibels higher than our frequency bins in the 2k octave. But the banded data is even, it's level between the 1k and 2k octaves, because the doubling of frequency bins in the 2k octave results in a 3 decibel boost in our banding data, representing a doubling of power. If you feel like you've learned something in this or any of the other videos on this channel, clicking like or leaving a comment would be really greatly appreciated. And if you want to learn more, I hope you'll consider subscribing. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video.